Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Mason Dambrot. Critical Thought TV looks at the relation between different areas of human knowledge and creativity and looks at the future of science, technology, and the human experience. We're very pleased to have today as our guest, Jason Silva, the ecstatic futurist.
Oh, thanks for having me.
And one thing that Jason has spoken about before, which really is kind of critical to his view of the emerging future we're moving into, is techno-optimism.
Yes.
And I'd like very much for Jason, if you would, to explain that and how it impacts all of these other areas.
Yeah, well, you know, techno-optimism is a term that I can't even remember where I first came across it, but I thought it was very self-defining. And of course, it comes to mean optimism about the impact and role that technology will continue to have on the future of humanity. Unfortunately, you know, we have a cultural situation today where if it bleeds, it leads. You know, the ability of information to be everywhere at once means that we can focus on all that is bad in the world, in spite of the fact that, by many accounts, the world has never been better. Steven Pinker has this wonderful TED Talk called The Myth of Violence that reminds us that we live in a world where the chances of a man dying at the hands of another man are lower than they've ever been, and he cites all these different ways in which the world is increasingly less violent than ever. Matt Ridley, who wrote Rational Optimist, has another TED Talk called When Ideas Have Sex, and it talks about the fact that ideas can just come together and sort of coalesce and self-organize and splurge, you know, sprout new ideas into existence. It goes into the whole Stephen Johnson notion of where big ideas come from, the rise of the coffee shop, smart people, caffeine, tight spaces together, sprouts complexity, sprouts new ideas. So I see optimism, I see reasons for being optimist everywhere, and particularly when looking at technology as this extension of our humanity, of an extension of our thought, reach, and vision.
Let me ask a question related to one of our earlier topics today, and that is synthetic biology. Mm-hmm. What do you think it will take for us to get beyond our biological imperative towards extreme aggression? The technology is neutral. It can be used for a wide variety of things. Einsteinian relativity led to nuclear medical devices and things that could do a lot of harm to a lot of people without much effort. Do you think that's something that we could address through accelerated evolution, which we've now accomplished in Drosophila? But it seems that accelerating human evolution might be a ways off. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, you know, I think Ray Kurzweil said this during his keynote at the Singularity Summit. Whoever discovered how to make fire was probably burned at the stake by his contemporaries.
Which is kind of funny, since they used fire to do so.
Yeah, exactly. And of course, so if you think, if technology is an extension of our nervous systems, is an extension of our will and our intent out in the world, a way by which we mediate our ability to actualize our inner world in the outer world, bring our dreams into existence through these technologies, they can go either way. You can use fire to cook your meal or to burn your enemy. You can use the technology of the alphabet to conjure up Nazi hate speech, or you can use it to write Shakespearean sonnets and, using the new number code, write mathematical equation, program computers. You know, that's the thing. You can use the technology of music to compose Beethoven's Fifth Symphony or to make some horrific musical disgusting work of art.
Or sometimes both, as in the off-sided, off-quoted phrase, let loose the dogs of war.
Okay, so the whole point being, it's up to us as people who want to have a seat at the table of that conversation, of the narrative. This is where the story matters. This is where the technology of human culture as this epigenetic phenomenon that can influence, if we can influence the story, if we can influence how people think about these things, we can influence the intent that people will have when they are empowered by these technologies, and they will come to see that we, in fact, need to leverage these technologies to address global challenges. Like Singularity University, for example, teaches its students how to leverage exponentially growing technologies to help 1 billion people. So I think that's the narrative that we're seeing, and I'm confident, based on everything that I've come across, that we'll be fine.
There are others who, speaking of Singularity University and the Singularity Institute, Yudkowsky, for example, are continually looking at ways to affect the emergent AGI, artificial general intelligence, to ensure as far as possible that it either likes us or at least doesn't dislike us, mm-hmm. if you will, to make it overly simplistic. Now, that always struck me as somewhat contradictory, because if it is an emergent AGI, just how much control can you have over an independent intelligence? And I was wondering how techno-optimism fits into this unpredictability that's inherent in sufficiently advanced computational architectures.
I think you take the long view. You start with the universe, and then you look back, and you see if progress is change, and change itself is speeding up. Evolution has evolved its own evolvability, as Kevin Kelly says. It took, you know, a billion years or whatnot to get to human beings, these entities that were intelligent and invented language, and then in the last 50,000 years, we've created more change than in the last billion, and that will continue with generalized artificial intelligence that can augment itself without limit. And so what I imagine is more progress at a faster and faster rate until it literally becomes a dizzying, rousing symphonic climax, the spillover of intelligence transcending entropy,
the end of
crescendo of awe.
The end of permanence.
The end of permanence.
In a sense, in terms of...
Well, the end of entropic impermanence.
Oh, that's interesting.
And but the end of stagnation, I think.
Oh, that's a much better way of putting it.
Yeah.
What I was thinking about when I said that was something along the lines of, if the distance, as we spoke in an earlier segment today, between ideation and actualization increasingly shrinks, it essentially becomes real time.
Oh yeah.
So in that sense, things, and as you mentioned in one of your other documentaries, that there's no time for it to become institutionalized.
It just is.
It just is.
Reality will be mediated by our thinking. So it'll be what all the new age thinkers are already saying. It'll just be that much more actualized. Like, yes, our thoughts will create reality, but it'll be like really literal, not just metaphorical.
So perhaps we can summarize today's conversation by citing Arthur C. Clarke, who said one of my favorite things of all time, which is when we are in that, when we are in that state of transhumanism, post-singularity, we'll be living in a magical world, because Arthur C. Clarke said it best, any sufficiently advanced technology appears to be magic.
Couldn't say it better myself.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much. This was great.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.